O'clock, we'll go ahead and call the meeting to order. Roll call, Jerry, if you would note, planning commissioners, Hall, well, Karen, Jim, Barb are out today and sitting in today. We have two county board commissioners, George Farabee and Deb Hadcock, so. Approval of the May 26th minutes. And for the audience, if you haven't grabbed the agenda, they are in the back bookshelves there if you need an agenda. Approval of the May 26th minutes. We are in our packets. Any revisions, corrections, additions, deletions? If none, I'd entertain a motion for approval of the minutes as published.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion to approve the minutes is carried. Approval of the agenda, again, for the audience, we do have the agenda in the back. We are going to move agenda item 14 before item 10, right after the proposed items for the consent calendar. And when we approve the agenda, it's with a we aren't approving the consent calendar right now, but we're approving the agenda that includes the consent calendar items, and then we'll come back and ask the Planning Commission staff and audience if you'd like to pull any of the consent calendars before we move into that. Any other than moving 14 before item 10, is there any other changes or additions to the agenda? Hearing none, I'd entertain a motion for approval of the agenda.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion and second for approval of the agenda. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. The agenda is approved. Consent calendar, the following items have been placed on the consent calendar for action to be taken by all items in accordance with staff's recommendation by a single vote. Any item may be removed from the consent calendar by the planning commissioner, staff member, or audience member for separate consideration. The findings of the Planning Commission are recommendations of the Pennington County Board of Commissioners who make the final decision, except on CUPs unless they're contested. With that, we'll first go to the Planning Commission. Any items that you'd like pulled for further discussion? Staff, any items to be
Nothing
pulled?
Nothing to pull.
PJ, would you read items for the record for items 3 through 9 of the consent calendar?
PJ Conover, Planning Department Director. Item 3, Conditional Use Permit Review 0101 for Charles and Ursula Brackett to review a mobile home park in suburban residential district. Staff recommends to continue the review of CUP 0101 to the June 22nd, 2015 Planning Commission meeting. Item number 4, Conditional Use Permit Review 0236 for Homer Berger to review a caretaker's residence in the limited agriculture district. Staff recommends approval of the extension of Conditional Use Permit 0236 with 4 conditions. Item number 5, Conditional Use Permit Review 1030 for Janelle Gibson, David, and Maria Eisenbrown as the owners to review the operation of a dog and cat kennel and breeding facility in a general agriculture district. Staff recommends to continue the review of Conditional Use Permit 1030 to July 13th, 2015 Planning Commission meeting. Item 6, Conditional Use Permit Review 1212 for Galen and Linda Livermont to review a camper to be used as living quarters on a temporary basis on the subject property and to allow for accessory structures to be located on the property prior to the primary structure in a general agriculture district. Staff recommends to revoke Conditional Use Permit 1212 with the applicant's concurrence. Item 7, Conditional Use Permit Review 1312 for Donald Johnson to review a single-wide mobile home to be used as a single-family residence in a suburban residential district. Staff recommends approval of the extension of Conditional Use Permit 1312 with 7 conditions. Item 8, Conditional Use Permit Review 1313 for Ronald Simpson to review an existing residence to be used as a temporary residence while constructing a new residence in a general agriculture district. Staff recommends to revoke Conditional Use Permit 1313 with the applicant's concurrence. Item 9, Conditional Use Permit Review 1419 for Christina Troutman to review an accessory structure, a shed or garage, prior to a primary structural in a general agriculture district. Staff recommends the approval of the extension of Conditional Use Permit 1419 with 10 conditions.
Is there anyone in the audience that would like any of those items that were just read into the record, 3 through 9, to be pulled for further consideration? Before I go for vote for that, just to let you know, the Planning Commission's bylaws state that you need a, basically a majority of the Planning Commission, not necessarily just the five quorum. The Planning Commission's seven, so any action to have final action today requires approval of four. And also, just as we go forward, this is a recommending body to the planning, county planning commission. So, I'm sorry, the county board. And so items can get appealed or will be for final approval to the county board. And also, because of the large audience present, as we get into further discussion, please try to limit your points to 5 minutes. If you're presenting on something that someone's previously said to make that point, please try not to repeat points, and limit your discussion to 5 minutes if you could. With that, we'll move for approval of the consent calendar as read into the record. I entertain a motion for approval of the consent calendar.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. The consent calendar is approved. And with the approval agenda, we moved item 14 up, so we'll go to item 14.
Yep. Item 14 is rezone 1507 and comprehensive plan amendment 1507 to rezone 145 acres from general agriculture district and highway service district to heavy industrial district, and to amend the comprehensive plan to change the future land use from limited agriculture district, low density residential district, and highway service district to heavy industrial district. The applicant is Kroll Ready Mix, and the agent is Joe Kroll. There are two representatives from Kroll Ready Mix in the audience today. They also have a presentation after staff presentation. The size of the subject property is approximately 145 acres, and existing land use is vacant and agriculture. Just as a note, mining is permitted. A permitted use in the current zoning, which is general agriculture, but not in highway service. However, the applicants are asking to change the rezoning to a more permanent purposing of the property. In heavy industrial, the following is allowed with permits: rock, sand, gravel, and earth excavation, crushing, and distribution, and that's section 212B12 of the Pennington County Zoning Ordinance. There are two distinct properties involved with this rezone request. If you can see the screen here, essentially you have this area here, which is again currently zoned general agriculture. There is a property that actually crosses the highway here. It's this one labeled in blue, and then this area over here, but the applicants are only asking to rezone the western half of the property. This section here has general agriculture and highway service district in it, but they're looking to do the entire thing into highway heavy industrial. Staff reviewed the properties in the Register of Deeds office and located Book 88, page 6618 through 6621, a materials lease agreement, which was put into effect on March 9, 2001 by the landowner. And this allowed for mining and processing of earthen materials, sand, gravel, and or limestone by a contractor on the owner's property. This lease had a 5-year lifespan and has since expired in 2004. But basically what it was, and if you can look at the screens here, you have section 9 here and section 10 over here. It was the entire east half of section 9 and the entire west half of section 10, approximately 640 acres. There is an active gravel quarry down here to the south, which has been in use for some time and actually has a conditional use permit to keep it operating and goes under regular review. Again, that lease agreement has expired as of November 4th, 2004. The current zoning around the property is general agriculture, limited agriculture, low density residential, planned unit development, suburban residential, and highway services, and that's within 2 miles. That plus a 6-mile radius, all those that were listed, plus heavy industrial, light industrial, and PUD, and also the city limits of the city of Rapid City. Within 2 miles, as far as the future land use, general agriculture, limited agriculture, low density residential, suburban residential, planned unit development sensitive, and highway services. Going out to 6 miles, all of the ones that were just indicated, plus the city limits of Rapid City. The subject properties do exist within the 3-mile platting jurisdiction of the city of Rapid City. This item was routed through the interdepartmental review. The County Highway Department had no comment. Other comments of note, the County Water Protection Coordinator stated that under Section 212 Heavy Industrial District, on purposes of this district is to allow rock, sand, gravel, and earth excavation, crushing, or distribution. The applicant has indicated that is the intended use of the property and if it is rezoned. Extraction of any material or substance exceeding 100 cubic yards from the earth requires a mining permit. The County Fire Coordinator also sent some comments back essentially about concerns with ingress and egress and the amount of traffic and trucks that would be going in and out of the subject properties. The fire coordinator also routed it to Gail Schmidt, the Rockerville Fire Department Fire Chief. Her concerns were also about ingress and egress. She did make a recommendation at the very least that turn lanes in both directions of traffic be added on Highway 16. Other concern she had was the possibility of dust coming up from the quarry from daily operations because it causes false alarms for her fire department to come out and check on the scene. The County Fire Coordinator later also commented that they needed to require Kroll to put up signs on the north and southbound lanes when they are blasting or doing any operation. Again, this is to minimize the amount of false alarms due to dust in the air. Other item of note were comments that came back from the South Dakota Department of Transportation from Stacy Bartlett. She says the DOT has control of the access on US 16 and Kroll will need to adhere to all control of access rules. On June 2nd, Stacy also commented that DOT will not relinquish control of access and no new access points will be allowed, but the landowner may use the existing approach off of Highway 16. Staff asked for some clarifications on her comments, and these were provided at a later date. DOT said that the access is on the north end of the property, and the access would be shared with Independence Hall's south access. Staff asked, with the amount of trucks going in and out, if the highway was able to handle the amount of traffic. DOT's response was the highway is built to handle truck traffic, but turn lanes would be needed, and that would be at the expense of Kroll. Staff also asked what the road speed was for the road, and mainly for the commissioner's interest, it's 60 miles an hour at this point. Black Hills Electric also commented, Black Hills Electric suggests leaving a tree barrier where possible, between the mining operation and Highway 16 to reduce the visual and noise impacts and to minimize the amount of dust in the air. Vicki Fisher from the city's planning department also commented that the city's future land use plan identifies the appropriate use of this property as general agriculture. Again, the city was routed on this as it exists in the 3-mile platting jurisdiction of the city of Rapid City. Also, she noted that US Highway 16 is a gateway from Rapid City into the Black Hills. She also advised us to get comments back from City's Public Works Division. We did receive comments back from Ted Johnson, an engineer for the city, and he indicated that the Public Works Engineering has no objection to the proposed rezone and comp plan amendment contingent on applicant obtaining required mining permits and providing adequate stormwater and erosion and sediment control on the site and site reclamation. Also, Vicki recommended that staff get more comments back from the Public Works Division regarding streets, drainage, and utilities. As of June 4th and as of this morning, no comments were received back from that department on those specific items. The applicant is also asked to change the comprehensive plan from limited agriculture, highway service district, and low density residential to heavy industrial. On page 8, that second to last paragraph there, it has highway services that should actually be heavy industrial. At the time of the staff writing, our office received no less than 5 phone calls from concerned citizens. Essentially, what they were concerned about were mining trucks entering and exiting the location, blasting, the property values, tracking of debris on the Highway 16, and the dust. There is one comment that came in from a citizen, Baron Wendt, which has been attached into your staff report and also the packet that you received this morning from concerned citizens and also the petition that was signed. Overall analysis by staff, the applicant's request appears to be spot zoning, as the closest similar zoning is over 5 miles to the northeast of the subject property, and the surrounding zoning does not appear to be compatible. There are tourist attractions in the area. Some of note, Founding Fathers, Bear Country, Dinosaur Museum, and Reptile Gardens. Again, less than 0.35 miles to the south, there is an active quarry with an active conditional use permit nearby. If rezoned, the applicants will be required to obtain a construction or a mining permit, more likely a mining permit. If rezoned, 1507 and 1507 are not approved. The applicants still do have the opportunity to keep the existing zoning, which is general agriculture, and mining is a permitted use on general agricultural land, but they would still be required to get a mining or a construction permit. Staff recommends to deny without prejudice rezone 1507 and comprehensive plan 1507, as the request does not appear to be compatible with the current and future zoning, and the applicant's request may be allowed using current zoning plus permits without a change in the current and future zoning of the subject properties.
Start off with questions for staff. Lori.
PJ, can you tell me about the mining operation to the south? Can you just give a brief overview of that?
Yep, it's basically just they have stockpiles there. A lot of times we have additional conditional use permits that are put in place for like bituminous paving just to have a little site available. There are no complaints that have come to the office that I'm aware of recently about it. It's not like deep mining. It's basically, I don't know what the technical word is for, but they're not going too far into the earth. And again, there's been no complaints about that one.
And can you tell me how long that condition, you said that conditional use permit has been in fact, how many years?
What would you guess?
About? And it comes up for review periodically?
Complaint basis.
Yeah.
10 years or more?
Yeah.
At least?
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
PJ, you said that this is general agriculture district, right?
Correct.
And mining is permitted in general agriculture. Why I can't say that late.
Yeah.
GA district.
Yeah, that's fine.
Thank you. Yep. I have no idea why I can't say that today. So why are you denying it? Because of it doesn't fit the future land use? Because it is zoned what?
It's GA currently general agriculture, and it's the future land use is limited agriculture. Denying because it appears to at staff's review to be spot zoning, not the rezone only, not the actual operation, the rezone.
Okay.
We're denying the rezone to heavy industrial because that does not appear to be compatible with our current or future land use. And they can also apply for permits as they're currently zoned. They're looking for something more permanent. If they rezone to heavy industrial, it actually repurposes the property. Follow?
Yeah. Oh, but that's okay. So the general agriculture basically the mining permit doesn't allow what heavy industrial will permit.
They're going to need a mining permit regardless.
Right.
But zoning there, and you can change it later if you want, but I believe the intent to go to heavy industrial is it's in their mind a more appropriate, more permanent zoning.
So you can do mining in general agriculture, but
with
not
permits.
Limited, but not limited agriculture.
Well, let me double check that one for you.
And this is zone limited agriculture.
General ag.
It's general ag now. The future land use is limited.
I thought you just told me it was limited ag, but.
Future land use.
Future is.
Okay.
Yep. And I don't see mining in here in limited agriculture.
Other questions for PJ?
Yes, do they do blasting and have air quality control? Problems or complaints up further where they already are doing some of this already?
The existing?
Yes. Plant,
we have received any complaints in our office.
No complaints. Do they blast and do everything that this company would do?
I'm not sure.
That would make a difference of what that company's doing, and if there hasn't been complaints from that from that company, I'm trying to figure out why this would be different.
It's a lot more of like, I believe is more, the difference more like a gravel quarry.
And how big is the other one that's further down? Is it 40 acres? Is it 120 acres? Is it 10 acres?
Well, it's probably over 10 acres.
I didn't say I was in agreement with this, but you can't tell one company it's okay and get a conditional use permit and tell the other company you're not quite going to.
We're not denying the operation of mining. We're denying, without prejudice, the rezone, not the actual operation. Two different things.
Which shuts them down, doesn't it?
The mining, no, they could still come back with a mining permit, and it would still be heard at a public hearing. We're just denying the rezone, not the actual operation of mining.
Okay.
Other questions for PJ?
Did you figure out how many acres the other one was, PJ?
I could pull it up on Rapid Map if you'd like.
Yes, PJ, I did have a question for you, I guess. The DOT comments are fairly limited, and I know a lot of times that's been the case, but
yes.
Was there any discussion or further information as far as not only turn lanes, but acceleration and deceleration lanes, or?
Nothing that specific. I know the applicants have had some discussions with DOT. They might be able to clarify a little bit more. DOT has gone through between Mike Carlson, who used to comment for us, and now over to Stacy. And it's a little more difficult to get information out of Stacy, hence why their comments were so long, because staff had to keep asking her to go deeper and deeper into her information.
And they could only use the existing access only. They cannot make any more. So that's going to be major traffic coming.
That was their comments. I don't know if that has changed.
Can I make one comment too? You might remember that the speed limit through that area was reduced several years ago. It used to be 65. And they put the rumble bars on either side and reduced it to 60.
Yeah.
So that's part of what DOT did.
And if you're having some big trucks and stuff come out of there, that might be a huge impact on what that speed limit and what that area can hold.
So Deb, to answer your acreage, we're approximately 50 acres.
Thank you.
For the existing operation?
For the existing, yeah.
Okay.
Not including the ingress-egress road to the west.
If you have big trucks, what I mean, Lori, is if you have the big trucks and stuff coming out there and it's at the bottom, you're going to slow everybody down and change that speed limit going up and down. And
that happens every time big trucks go up that hill.
Yes,
yeah,
that's what I'm saying. Or come down if cars are coming down,
yeah,
for safety factors. So,
Can I ask one more question? I'm assuming the person operating to the south is not the same company?
Correct.
Okay.
Are there questions for staff? If not, you said the applicant wanted to make a presentation?
Yes. Okay. Let me get that. We'll start at 4.
Go to the applicant then.
My name is Kyle Freisinger. I'm with Kroll Ready Mix.
My name is Matt McPhee with Kroll Ready Mix.
Good morning, planning commissioners and county commissioners. This morning we have some information to present regarding our rezone application and comprehensive plan amendment. In regards to our company, Brian Marchin is actually our general manager of the West. Unfortunately, he could not make it this morning. Matt McPhee is one of our aggregate managers, and myself also an aggregate manager. We have a regional office in Sundance, Wyoming, and we are local here in Rapid City, Dias Avenue, Rapid City, where our Ready Mix plant's located at. A little bit about us, our company history. Roger Kroll started operations in Lawler, Iowa in 1968. Grew in Iowa, Minnesota, and Wisconsin. We are local area. He purchased Sundance, Wyoming regional office in 1997 and installed Ready Mix plants in Spearfish and Belle Fourche. Current operations company-wide include 80 locations in 6 states, including aggregate, Ready Mix concrete, and mainline concrete paving. We are a second generation owned company. Kurt Kroll is actually our president currently. Corporate headquarters are in New Hampton, Iowa, and again, our regional office is in Sundance, Wyoming. Regionally, we employ over 200 drivers and equipment operators. We have 14 aggregate locations and 24 ready mix concrete locations. We're presenting this application for rezoning to rezone from agricultural to industrial. The property consists of 145 acres in Section 9 and 10, Township 1 South, Range 7 East, Pennington County. This map is real similar to what PJ had showed the area in question west of Highway 16 again. Bear Country is right here to the south, Founding Fathers. Active Rock Quarry to the south, Pearly Quarry and Bear Country to the west. So, property consists of 145 acres lying west of Highway 16, 2 miles south of Rapid City. Surrounding land uses include agricultural, rangeland, tourism, and mining. Property owners are Robert Taylor Family Trust, and we have an exclusive right to purchase the property. Again, Exhibit B is same map, a little bit blown out again. Reptile Gardens in the center, Founding Fathers directly to the south, active quarry to the south end of the property, Bear Country's on our west side, rangeland, heavily forest to the north. Some pictures of the existing property. This is taken from the northeast portion of the property across east of Highway 16. Again, heavily wooded. This picture is taken from the Moon Meadows area. Founding Fathers on your lower left-hand side. We are directly to the south of Founding Fathers, traveling east and west. This picture is taken from the Founding Fathers Highway 16 junction, looking southwest on the property. And again, another picture farther south, looking northwest onto the property. Our property assessment, again, much similar to what PJ did. Permanent man-made structures, none. No utilities. Current use is rangeland, is heavily wooded. No current road access. Present zone is agricultural. Current adjacent properties are to the north, rangeland and tourism. To the west, rangeland and tourism. To the south, rangeland, mining. And we're bordered by the east by the Highway 16 right-of-way. Why rezoning? Our goal of rezoning would be to allow mining on the property. Limestone rock would be crushed and screened into construction aggregate to feed the surrounding area, including Rapid City. Aggregate would be used at our ready-mix plants at Rapid City, Wall, Myrtle, Kadoka, Shatterin, Nebraska, and Alliance, Nebraska. This is a portion from Pennington County zoning district, zoning manual. Item 12, again, under heavy industrial district, allows rock, sand, and gravel or earth excavation, crushing or crushing or distribution. Overview, haul road access would be needed to access the property from Highway 16. The necessary permit application has been submitted to the South Dakota Department of Transportation, and we are currently meeting with them in regards to their what they'll grant us. Truck traffic is expected to be up to 75 trucks per day, 5 to 6 days per week. Average truck traffic would just be 15 trucks a day. Sales are estimated to be seasonal with more activity.
Excuse me, sir, that's the large trucks, right?
That is gravel trucks. It could be dump trucks or trucks carrying.
Typically large trucks, though.
Yes, well, yeah. It'd be dump trucks or greater, yes.
Thank you.
Does it include belly dumps or side dumps?
Yeah. Average trucks, 15 trucks a day. Sales are estimated to be more seasonal with more activity in the summer following the typical highway construction season. BMPs would be implemented on the gravel haul road, including water dust control and magnesium chloride dust suppression. Exhibit C1 was our proposed haul road. Again, we are negotiating with DOT on access to the south. They have denied us that access. And we are currently still talking with both Mike Carlson and Stacy with the DOT and Pier. Exhibit C2 is actually the access that DOT has granted us. The east-west line is a section line, and they stated that we should have our access on that east-west section line.
Mr. Chair, excuse me, sir. Now, back to the Exhibit C1.
Mm-hmm.
That access, there's a current approach there, correct?
There is not.
Just as you break around the hill?
There is not a current approach there.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Our original haul road access is Exhibit C1. The distance from that haul road access to Founding Fathers exit is approximately 1,400 feet. Distance from the south access, and again, Exhibit C1 is south to the Pearly Rock Quarry is 6,000 feet to the south. Speed limit is always enforced within all of our quarry boundaries at 25 miles an hour, and we would propose stop signs at the entrance of Highway 16, along with truck crossing signs on Highway 16. Again, this is our proposed haul road to the south in the general area looking south. Looking to the north, good view, good line of sight. Again, to the east, we are bordered by Highway 16. There is not a current median crossover in that area, and we have had comments from DOT if XL, D-cell lanes, median crossovers would be at the cost of coral ready mix. This is an example of a typical highway crossing in, that's currently in use on exit on Highway 16. Ours would be real similar. Notice the width. It is actually a lot of trucks come out on this access here. And again, the same crossing. It's an existing crossing to the south. You know, we feel that we can build something similar. They do have a median crossover for trucks going both north and south there. Our mining plan, basically our first step would be our haul road would be constructed. We are leaving a buffer area left to Highway 16, left adjacent to Highway 16. It would consist of no mining of 11 acres. The outside perimeter of the quarry would be established. We'd leave a 25-foot buffer zone against neighboring property. The plant stockpile area would be logged of existing trees and stripped of topsoil and overburden. Plant area would then be graveled. Plant area is roughly 7 acres. We would install a water well, would be drilled on the mining area, near the mining area for access for water, for dust control and haul road maintenance. Mining cells would be logged of existing trees. Logging would typically disturb two to three years in advance of mining. Mining cells would be anticipated 1 acre for early mining and commence 2 to 3 acres once quarry is established. And mining would commence to the west. Exhibit D1, example of our mining plan. Buffer starting at the far right, we are leaving 11 acres adjacent to Highway 16 for visual and noise effects. Proposed haul road is one of two. This one's actually the one drawn to the south. Plant staging area is a relatively flat area. The blocks are mining cell blocks representing a typical mine progression, mining progression to the west. Exhibit D2 is the same general characteristics with the different haul road that the DOT has granted us up to the section line. Typical mining operations would include loaders, trucks, crushers, screening plants, conveyors, truck scale, and office. Typically it'd be seasonal, most of the activity in the summer. If sales did not dictate that the plant would be moved off annually, then the only operation would be loading and scaling from existing stockpiles of crushed product. It is not anticipated a ready-mix concrete or an asphalt plant would reside on the property. Drilling of the limestone would be necessary. Blasting of the limestone is estimated to occur monthly. No explosives will be stored on site. All blasting will be monitored by portable seismograph machines. Machines will monitor both noise and vibration. All blasts will meet all necessary state and federal regulations. Hours of operation typically are 7 to 5, Monday through Friday, with occasional Saturday work during peak season. Picture of a typical rock crushing plant, real similar to our equipment. Crusher on the left, screening plant on the right. Again, real typical crushing plant. Loader on your lower right. This actually is a jaw crusher feeding a screen, separating materials, real similar to what we would propose. This picture is the typical Manicotti limestone of Black Hills, commonly mined in this area. It's a ledge, roughly 35 to 45 feet thick. It is covered with topsoil and overburden of varying depths. And at the base of the Manicotti limestone is typically Opeachy shale. The Opeachy shale does not have value. The limestone formation is a relatively thin deposit. common throughout Black Hills. And so it would not be any mining of any depth. It would typically be the depth of the ledge is roughly 40 feet. Life of the mine, roughly 25 years or greater. The end use of the property we feel would be residential. Visual impact of the mining property. There is a typo on this first line. It says leave 8-acre site. It actually is 11 acres. As not disturbed with exception of the haul road adjacent to Highway 16. We propose no signs will be placed adjacent to Highway 16 identifying the quarry location. 25-foot buffer zone placed against all neighboring properties. We are required for a variety of other permits to actively mine, basically in Pennington County and the state of South Dakota. South Dakota mining permit, stormwater permit, DOT road access permit, air quality permits for all crushers and screens on site, water well permit, construction permit, building permit for any permanent structures, also mining permits from Pennington County and all other permits as deemed necessary. We feel there's an economic impact of having a mine in Pennington County. There is an increase of sales tax. We would be selling to the typical contractors, highway construction. We do supply material to ourselves, but it is also our job to service the local area with construction materials. There is be increased tax revenue to Pennington County to rezone from ag to industrial. We all know that there's a difference in taxes. Job growth, we would be providing 5 to 6 employment initially, could grow 10 to 12 after sales base is established. And it is a viable rock source for growth for South and East Rapid City, along with Keystone and Hill City area as proof as another quarry already in the area. I wanted to address typical mining concerns. We know mining has a black eye, not necessarily in this area, but as a whole. Some things are due to bad operators, but Crow Ready Mix is a good operator, and that's why I wanted to talk about some of our mining, typical mining concerns from the traveling public. Truck traffic, we're actively working with DOT on an approach permit to allow truck safe access to Highway 16. Access to and from Highway 16 could be improved with acceleration and deceleration lanes. There are existing trucks in the area exiting and entering an adjacent rock quarry. So we would, there are other trucks in the area on that highway. As far as blasting is concerned, the limestone would have to be blasted. The limestone we'll be mining will need to be drilled and blasted. Again, we use a regional supplier for both drilling and blasting. Blasting is estimated to be done monthly during the production season. We will use portable seismographs to measure both noise and vibration. All blasting will meet all state and federal specifications. No blasting agents will be stored on site. As far as dust is concerned, all rock crushing and screening equipment is currently regulated by the South Dakota Department of Environment and Natural Resources. All crushing equipment will be permitted for use by SDDENR. All crushing equipment used on site will have water spray bars for dust suppression and will meet dust control limits. And lastly, haul road dust. Haul roads will be chemically treated using magnesium chloride to help control the dust. A water truck will also be used to help control spot dusting and dusting in and around the plant. A water well will be drilled on site for a water source for dust control. Topsoil and overburden stockpiles that are anticipated being left undisturbed for longer than 1 year will need to be graded and seeded. And lastly, a noise impact. We have safety devices on our crushing plants, on our mobile equipment, that are necessary precautions for safety. Backup alarms and startup sirens are two examples. Common in the construction industry, but we are proposing to leave an 11-acre buffer adjacent to Highway 16. It'd be natural vegetation buffer. This part of the property left untouched will help control any noise pollution that is created by the operation. And coincidentally, the closest full-time resident from the plant area is roughly 200 feet to the south, southeast as the crow flies. That would be east of Highway 16. Closest occupied building outside of the property is Founding Fathers LLC. From the plant area to his building is roughly 1,800 feet to the north. So at this time, I open up to the Planning Commission, the County Commissioners, for any questions.
I guess one thing that, as we go forward, not only for you, you kind of opened the door on this, so I'm going to let the opposition have some latitude too, because really you barely touched on the rezone. You talked about the mining and the construction permit, which is a separate process, and today's hearing is only for the rezone. It's good information, but I mean, really, it's more applicable for the discussion on the mining and the construction permit. So I'm assuming that we're going to, giving you that latitude, we'll give the opposition the latitude too on some of their discussion as far as the rezone. I do have a question, I guess, as far as if I understand what you said, and it's what's in our packet, you are not the current owners of the property.
We are not.
Okay. And then one question I had, I guess you were saying about the 2,000 feet, and maybe PJ, I may need your help on this, but on the D1, D2 exhibits, it's showing mine progressions, and it looks like it's a subdivision, and it's only showing a 25-foot setback from property boundaries. I guess my concern would be a noise for the, if those are subdivisions, or what are the loop lines? Is that something that's not a subdivision?
I think the area you're talking about is on the far left-hand corner. That's actually
right.
That's
correct.
Actually bear country.
Oh, that's bear country. Okay. Okay. Anyway, go to question. Other questions from the Planning Commission and commissioners. George is there.
Well, I certainly agree, Mr. Chair, that this is supposed to be about a rezone, and I had listened intently for rezone comments, and if they were if you said them, I didn't hear them. Can you explain why you want the rezone?
Well, we feel as a company, due to the investment of the property, it was in Kroll Ready Mix's best interest to rezone the property for our application. We know we have rights to retain a mining permit renewed annually on a complaint basis, but due to the high investment of this property, we wanted to make a long-term commitment and felt rezone was the proper application.
PJ, can I ask you a question? I'm looking at the ordinance. This is general ag, right?
Correct.
Okay, and one of the uses is listed as mining.
With the permit.
With a construction permit. Then when you go to the mining permit section, so they don't need a mining permit, they need a construction permit.
Brittany, you want to address that?
Because the mining permit thing says, mining permits shall not be required for work in general ag for construction, but it says which is agriculturally related.
That's
and since
not.
This is not agriculturally related, that's why you need a construction and a mining permit, correct?
Correct. Well, what we've done in the past is we've required one or the other because you're going to have the same conditions. Mm-hmm. So instead of making them go through a construction permit because they're doing the disturbance and the excavation, when you look at the rezone, and PJ and I have gone over it with them, the rezone is actually repurposing that property for that. So in the general ag district, I believe the reasoning for that mining allowance was to do these small gravel pits that we see all the time to maintain roads in more rural areas.
Okay.
I believe that that's the intent of that under there. When we discussed it with them, like they said, they wanted something more permanent where they repurpose that land, and that's what the rezone would do.
So with the general ag designation they have right now, they need to come to you to get a permit, which is a construction slash mining permit.
Correct.
Where the main focus is air quality and stormwater.
Right.
Control,
it would be
right?
Your best management practices. Yes.
Thank you.
And that's always renewed just on an annual basis?
We have been doing them annually. And then if there's no complaints or no concerns and they're meeting all of their conditions, we've moved them to 5 years.
Okay.
My concern is... Sorry, sir.
Go ahead.
You go first.
Well, Mr. Chair, if I can finish on the...
George finished, and then Sabre.
Sorry, connected to the rezone request, And I'll have to apologize. I don't know what the stringency of the requirements for it. Your chart mentioned the South Dakota mining permit from, you know, from DNR.
Mm-hmm.
Can you enlighten us as to how stringent those requirements are? And let me follow up before you answer. The permit then from PIR or from DNR, then that's long lasting or that's annual or whatever.
South Dakota DENR does provide mining permits. Typically, county ordinances are going to be tougher than the statewide permit. They do come out periodically for inspections, not annually necessarily. And that's part of the process where we actually provide a bond for reclamation.
Okay. Thank you.
Deb, going to you.
You can go first if you want.
No, go ahead.
Okay. Just a couple things I'll say up straight. Just for mining in this area, here's my concerns. Your decibel level for noise, sirens, blasting, alarms, safety devices. You're kind of in the dip of the area, and there's a lot of people living around there. And I went through a thing with Black Hills Power and their decibel levels of noise that they didn't think it bothered anybody. But even those low levels of noise and even your blasting can do some major effects. You said you're on shale. You said you're on limestone. That blasting could affect the surrounding areas. I'm not a mining engineer. The dust and air quality, when I was on the city board, we had lots of complaints for some of the companies that we have close to neighborhoods and stuff in Rapid City. Mm-hmm. You're also in an area where that dust and that wind is going to blow and do some major air quality control issues in that area. It's a tourism industry in South Dakota here and an agricultural industry, but in that area it's actually tourism. You're on top of a hill and you're coming in 16, or you're on the other side, whether you're south or north coming into that area, they're going to see a gravel company in the middle of that corridor. No offense, but you're not very good to look at. So say it up straight. You're going to be digging 40 feet in, and you also, my concern is 25 years or greater, you can expand that area. You also have neighborhoods. You have animals. You have bear country, and I'm surprised they haven't said anything about noise, blasting, and some other things for those animals that are right south of you, right on that corner. So why you picked this area without sounding too mean to me is, I know why you picked it, okay? It's good for a gravel pit. So for me, I don't believe it's the best possible area for Rapid City to put a gravel pit. I'll just say it up straight to you, just because of those concerns and the traffic. Traffic with the trucks up and down those hills and what that's going to do to that corridor and the cost it's going to cost the taxpayers to keep those roads up that actually been doing pretty well.
And, you know, to respond, we don't necessarily pick where the limestone's at.
Right, and I knew
that. And I hope, you know, I've been doing this for over 20 years. Unfortunately, cities and counties expand on one common rural areas where natural deposits are common. And I hope everyone understands that rock, sand, and gravel are necessary for development, whether it's a single residence, hospital, commercial development, highways. Without mines, there wouldn't be developments. If it was up to me, we would always be out of town, but it's not.
And I appreciate that, but we take pride in, I believe, in Rapid City and Pennington County to make things as beautiful as we can. And in a tourist area, that's a major concern for me because that's one of our biggest industries in South Dakota, and that is a big area for tourism in that district and an inlet and outlet for that district, sir. So not personal for you in a sense, but... that would be my concern, sir.
Mr. Chairman.
Go ahead, Bill.
This area that you've selected appears to be a direct contributor to the non-attainment area of Rapid City's air quality. And the picture you show in your presentation indicates a lot of dust coming off your piles. which I don't think is representative of using the water bars that you said you were going to incorporate in your operation. So I don't know how much more effect this is going to have on the non-attainment area that we've already got established in this Rapid City area, because I know the prevailing winds during the summer months are from the southeast, which is going to contribute to this area. And that would be my concern, primary concern.
I guess a comment that I was going to make, and similar to where I started, this is a rezoning issue. Mm-hmm. And you know, you'll have to go through a lot of this presentation when you actually go for your mining or construction permit. But on the rezone, I guess I'd like a little more discussion on that as far as you're saying, because if it's under ag, it'd be a construction permit that's reviewed on an annual basis. Mm-hmm. I think that's going to be true regardless. And I guess the question is why would you be afraid of that? If you're going to be a good neighbor and comply with everything, it should automatically be renewed. You know, to me, it's sort of like you're saying you want heavy industrial, so you don't have to worry about the possible, coming in front of the public again and getting scrutinized. And to me, that in this area in particular, is it's important to be scrutinized. And so I feel like, you know, you have the opportunity to mine a general ag with oversight, mm-hmm. and I think that's the county's role. I'd like to hear a little more on your argument of why go to light industrial.
Heavy
industrial. Heavy. Sorry.
Well, again, when we spoke with our owners, the desire was that we change the land qualification to match what it currently was, quote, we intended to use. During my initial conversations with the Planning and Zoning Department, it was under my understanding, and I may have been mistaken, that under heavy industrial, mining permit was not necessary. It was kind of an either-or application. Since that time, we have met with PJ. He has informed us that a mining permit is necessary under ag, and or if we go to industrial, it would be under industrial also. So. We may have misunderstood our first initial meeting with planning and zoning. But again, due to the high investment of this area, the price of the land, the price of the development, we wanted a permanent fix to change the land use.
Are there questions for the applicants before we go to the public?
I guess I might have one more question. Your intent is to purchase or lease?
Our intent is to purchase.
Thank you.
Kinsley, I may have a question for you. I assume you don't need to be, the applicant doesn't need to be the owner of land to rezone. I think that's true, but I just wanted to get that confirmation.
That is true.
Okay. I mean, because like you may intend on buying, I assume it's contingent on whether you can get this approval process?
Contingent on a number of items, yes.
Okay. Other questions for the applicants before we go to the public? Thanks. Give you the opportunity to come back too. So. PJ?
Just two quick items. During the initial discussions with the applicants, when we discussed the rezone over to heavy industrial, that repurposes the land. And then with the mining permit on that, it holds a little bit more weight than a mining permit in general agriculture, hence why one of the reasons why they chose to go over to heavy industrial. So there was good reason for it. Also, the other item which might actually come up, because staff field a lot of these questions, when this was advertised, a rezone is advertised 500 feet from the property line to all properties. On a comprehensive plan amendment, it's sent out to everybody within 500 feet, and then anybody zoned general agriculture in 2 miles. So there are people here today that did not receive notifications that are zoned either PUD or LDR or SRD that did not get notifications per our ordinance. So that may come up.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And again, I'm assuming we have a lot of people that wish to speak. If you could try to limit your discussions and not repeat what others may have presented. I had about 17 minutes of presentation done by Kroll. So anyway, but if you could try to limit your discussions to 5 minutes and not repeat. And again, the action here is for rezone. I would encourage, you know, if you're interested in the process, I would encourage to follow this when they come for their construction and mining permit. But that is not whether that mining permit or construction permit gets issued at a future date. That's not the issue in front of us today. It's whether it gets rezoned to heavy industrial or not. So with that, is there speakers in the public? Step forward and please state your name and.
My name is Sylvia Cox, and I reside at 23739 Arrow Road, which is probably, by the way, the crow flies, one of the closer residential properties to the property in question. And I have a lot of little questions, but I really want to only speak about one thing, and it is to your issue of zoning. And my understanding of the way the zoning law works is that if they are heavy industrial, then they can, in the future, pursue any of the activities are allowed under heavy industrial zoning. So with all their representations about hours, dust, water, whatever, they're very good, but they don't limit them once they're given the dispensation of the heavy industrial zoning. And I think that as with the Planning Commission, limited use permit permits them to do everything they want, but gives you the opportunity to oversee. And I think that another big question about giving them heavy industrial is, what else can they do in the future, and how will the property be used in the future? And no one has answered the question either, the extent to which, is it 40 feet of limestone, the extent to which it will be exhausted within the 25-year period, and then whatever use they might then care to make of a heavy industrial zone property. So I urge you to stick with the approach recommended by the Planning Board. Thank you.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Where do you live? In relation to the property?
On the other side of Route 16 out Neck Yoke Road, about halfway up the hill toward Coyote Flats.
You want to use the mouse?
You'd be east, right?
I'm not sure I can find it on here. These little roads are hard to find. Yeah. Can you help me? You know where Arrow Road is?
You said east, yeah. Neck, you're over by, Hart Ranch.
We drive up and down Route 16 all the time, and there are already traffic problems there. And I also feel sorry for the people at Independence Hall, because I think this would be a disaster for the Independence Hall operation.
Are you further east than this?
I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
So this is 16 right here.
Where's Neck Yoke Road?
I gotta get there.
To the east. That's.
What's that?
Let's see, Neck Yoke Road. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
That's okay. I mean, a couple miles away. North and east.
Arrow Road is right off Neck Yoke Road. We're practically due east from the property.
About a couple miles?
No, I don't think it's that far. Because Neck Yoke Road winds back around.
Yeah, I was just trying to get a general idea.
We definitely hear traffic from Route 16 where we live on a regular basis, even when it's not motorcycle season.
So do we. Thank you.
Thank
other
you.
Questions for Ms. Cox?
Yes.
Oh, just checking. We had other questions.
Thank you.
Thank you. I believe you got up first, and then we'll go to you next. So.
Good morning. My name is Wes Shelton. I don't own any property in the immediate area, but I drive by there regularly, and I can see it. The most important thing for me is I spent a decade leading the economic development effort in Rapid City. And I would have done anything possible to get a business into Rapid City if it made sense. In this case, this doesn't make sense. I just hope we don't approve heavy industrial zoning here. I hope we also don't allow a mining permit on that particular property, because I do think it's going to have a much heavier impact than the relatively small gravel pit that's there now. Thank you.
Questions for Mr. Shelton? Thank you. Go to you next. Thank you.
Thank you. My name is Patricia San Martin. I live at 13607 South Highway 16, which is about 2 miles south that way from the proposed mining operation.
If you could step maybe closer to mic or pull it toward you, so.
Is that better?
Yeah, I think so.
I also am a property owner on Duffer Drive, which is just directly east on Spring Creek Road from the proposed quarry. I happen to live about a half a mile from the Taylor Quarry, which is the other one that was mentioned. It is leased from the National Forest Service. It's been in existence for close to between 10 and 15 years now. When the people came to say it'd be nice, they'll keep it locked, it will be quiet. It is quiet. There's rarely dust. There's no problem with blasting. But we are subjected to people shooting AR-15s and all sorts of guns. It's become a gun range that's not supposed to be. It's a party area. It's not supposed to be. It's dangerous because of ricocheting bullets. Nobody can hike back there anymore. I worry about fire from people misusing the quarry. And that can happen here. I don't care. I don't care if they're going to have noise suppression, dust suppression, and everything else. What are they going to do when it's closed? They can't keep people from going in there. For the big trucks, since I also live basically across from the gas station on Highway 16, the side dumpers and the belly dumpers, every single time they go down that highway, will jake break. It's a lot louder than a bunch of Harleys. They do it every time. I don't know if they have an attraction for a gas station or what. They also like to go over the rumble strips. They just do it. And I think they're starting to break down the highway because there's been so much. I think it will definitely be bad for the Independence Hall business and increase the danger for our tourists. For locals and tourists alike, when they approach the hills from the north on Highway 16, you see this beautiful pine-covered ridge. And now it's going to start to look like West Rapid City and Piedmont and Black Hawk, and that's not a good ad for our beautiful Black Hills. So that takes care of the aesthetic pollution. I worry about environmental and hydrological concerns. Dust has been raised already. But because Spring Creek, show you. Spring Creek goes right down there, right there. And right about here in Spring Creek, there are a bunch of caves in there. It's where the sinkholes are in Spring Creek. Can you hear me? And that is a large supplier of the aquifer that supplies Rapid City. So I might suggest that a real hydrological survey be done there. Bear Country was brought up, some concern for the animals there. What about these people that live in Copper Oaks? They're really close. The prevailing winds a lot of times are from the west. They'll funnel right down here. If anybody knows what a Venturi effect is, this will increase the speed of the winds, carry them straight down here. Hart Ranch, Duffer Drive, all these homes right down here. Rapid City is growing up on that hill a lot more on Sammy's Trail. It's going to be dust. I have a list of 12 people that I represent from the Duffer Drive area today who wanted to be here and are not able to be here. If you wish to have their names, phones, anything, I'll give them to you. So I speak on their behalf, although they can't physically be in this venue today. And my last question is the potential deleterious effect on property values. And that's it. I thank you.
If you want to give the list to Jerry and she could include it with the record. PJ, do we have a laser pointer?
It gets absorbed by the
screen. Oh, by the screen? Okay.
Well, do you have
thanks. Any questions for Patricia? Thank you.
Morning. My name is Trevor Wendt. I live at 47th Avenue West. Apparently, I'm a little nervous. Sorry about that.
And if you could pull up the mic, too. Yeah. Thank you.
here today, just as a concerned homeowner living within a 2-mile radius, a couple points. Most of the ones that I've talked about have already been discussed, air pollution, noise pollution. I do have concerns about the blasting and home damage potential for shockwaves. I work near the Pete Lean mine in that area. We feel the percussions of those explosives when they set those off, and there has been damage to the building that I work in as well from that. On 47th Avenue Street, there's some others here today as well. Of those homes on that 47th Avenue Street, to my knowledge, only 4 people received a letter of this rezoning. I'm one of those persons. My home address is not agricultural. I don't know why I received the notice. I did. From the sounds of it, I should not have received it, although I believe for something of this magnitude, everybody in a 2-mile radius should have received a notice personally. You know, I have concerns about the truck traffic there on Highway 16 with the trucks coming in and out. The Pearly Pit, which is a third of the size of this proposed operation, we see a lot of traffic on 16, and we also hear the J-brakes and the noise from those trucks on 16 all year long. From a tourist point of view, a lot of that's been addressed as well. One of the photos in the presentation, like looking from Moon Meadows down that valley, that could have been in a brochure to visit the Black Hills. Once that logging's been done and the mining operation's been through there, that photo, you would not want that in a brochure. And lastly, I took it upon myself to talk to a lot of residents on 47th Avenue and Copper Oaks, and I've submitted a petition, signed petition with over 100 names of residents within the area, within a 2-mile radius of this proposed rezoning and mining operation. All of those signatures represent the opposal of the rezoning. And I would go ahead and say that those residents would also be opposed to the mining operation and permit for future discussion. So I kindly ask the commission to follow the staff recommendation and deny the rezoning application here today. The signatures, the 100 signatures, I've emailed to PJ. I do have a copy here if you'd like that as well.
Right, if you've emailed them, we have them for the record. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Is that the petition you were handed this morning?
Pardon me?
That in the packet?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah. Believe so, yep. Yeah. I believe she was up first, so let's go to her first. So.
Morning. My name is Karen Abad. I live at 23632 Wilderness Canyon Road in Copper Oaks. And just a couple of kind of technical concerns. I am a geologist. I worked for the U.S. Bureau of Mines for 20 years before the Bureau was closed quite a few years ago, and worked in the blasting group. And I just have a couple of geological concerns about the blasting. I know that it's been said that they would blast once a month or so, but I'd like to know if a really detailed geologic survey has been done to look at where that limestone is and what the propagation is going to look like of those blast waves. There are federal standards that people that I worked with put together out of Minneapolis. So I don't know why I'm so nervous up here. I teach seventh grade. I don't know why this is so hard to talk. If you want to talk about bacteria reproduction, I can do that easily. Just the propagation of those blasting waves is one concern. The other concern is the groundwater. If they're going to be drilling another well, what is that going to do to the local hydrology and the water from the well that is being used for Copper Oaks residents? So. Thank you.
Questions for Karen? Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
So far, I want to thank the audience for holding your remarks to 5 minutes. It's been great. So
my name is Gene
Bundy.
I'm sure
we got a lot more. So.
And I live at 13754 47th Avenue West.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch your name. I was
Gene Bundy. And I'm about 3/4 of a mile from the backside of the mine he's talking about. Our well for the entire, or not all of it, but a good portion of our street is less than a half a mile from the edge of his blasting zone or whatever, from the edge of his rezoning request. I'm very concerned. she led into it real well about the water problems. We've had a lot of problems with water up there the way it is because of the lack of it, I guess, the best way to say it. There's three or four different wells on 47th Avenue at this point, and none of them are capable of putting out more than probably 11 or 15 gallons a minute. If he damages that, we're sunk. So I'm very concerned about the water end of it. Okay?
Thank you. And again, just this is a rezoning action, but like I said, I think the door has been open as far as some of the mining applications, but these are important topics to bring up when the permit comes forward for mining or construction.
Good morning. My name is Vern Osterloh. I live at 23605 Wilderness Canyon Road, which is probably about a mile and a half from the boundary. Discussions already have been very good for the water, the blasting, things like that. I'd like to point out public safety. We drive that road coming up from Reptile Gardens up the hill, and we turn into Copper Oaks. Just regular truck traffic going down Highway 16 to Hill City, things like that. They've got their flashers on because some of them are only going 25 miles an hour to go up that hill. Now, you looked at the presentation of the company filing it here. He said it could be up to 75 trucks, and these are some heavy semis, belly dumps, things like that. Summertime, we've got campers, and then some of those big campers can only go like 40 miles an hour, and we've already got a reduced speed limit from 65 to 60, and if you get this area filled up with vehicles, large vehicles that can't even go 35 miles and up there, we're going to be backing things up, and somebody's going to get hurt or killed. And that's really what I'm going to try to push on the public safety. And one another point I think Deb is trying to allude to, and also Sig here, this is just a rezoning. And they are already allowed to mine in the area for their gravel and quarry, things like that. And it's under the scrutiny of the every five-year permit. If we go to heavy industrial, take a look at your manual. Look all that's is available for them to do in heavy industrial. And even if they don't quarry out for 25 years, that opens it up. They could set up concrete ready-mix plants. They could bring up anything, and you really don't have any control of that in heavy industrial because you give them the ticket to do whatever they want to do. So I guess I would ask you to honor the recommendation from your staff here to deny the rezoning request. Thank you very much.
Questions for Vern? Thank you.
Morning.
Morning.
My name is Barrett Wendt. I also live on 47th Avenue, just close to Gene and close to my brother, Trevor. And I help collect some of those signatures. Simply put, I would prefer to see this mine not go in, the zoning not be approved. They can do what they can do on limited agricultural. I think we as a city and as a county need to decide where we want our investment dollars. Is it in mining? Is it in tourism? Is it in residential? City's clearly growing south, and I would prefer to see investment in residential and other commercial and tourism industry rather than mining at that location. Nothing against mining. I know we need it, but that's not the proper place for it. So please stand by what the commission has recommended and deny that request. Thank you.
Any questions for the speaker? Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak?
Good morning. My name is Monty Hart. I'm one of the business owners that is somewhat affected in this. Where all the comments have been from residents, I own a business which is just located, which is a Sweetgrass Inn, Bed and Breakfast, and Shipwreck Leeds Restaurant. This was brought to my attention based upon, I just wanted to comment on my businesses being, or the business. There was a comment, this will bring economic development. by rezoning this. Well, it could negatively affect other businesses that are current and present that are already operating. It's funny, in one of their slides, they actually have us that show the traffic, and it's the back side of the sign that says heavy traffic, slow down, the whole works. In one of their slides, it's the DOT is already noting that this is going to be a big issue. And I am working with the DOT on the cross, when you cross over two lanes of highway. If I remember right, the comment was over 70% or most of the traffic will be turning south. So they are crossing over the south, or I'm sorry, most of the traffic will be heading north towards our plant, Rapid City, which means a truck has to cross the south, traffic going south. So there's a crossover. And that medium is probably shorter than what a double side truck or side dump traffic would be, or truck. The medium is only so many feet. I don't have those figures. I will next time I come for the mining. But that truck, the side dump trucks are wider than the medium is currently, I'm sure. So thank you for your time.
Any questions? Anyone else wishing to speak?
Good morning. I'm Don Perdue. I'm the founder and the president of the Founding Fathers. And needless to say, if I had my brothers, I'd rather not see it. And the main reason is, in fact, they're suggesting very strongly now that their egress will be the south border of our property. And in that knowledge and conversations with these fine gentlemen, and we were talking about operations and such, and I don't know how it ever got down from 150 trucks to 15, but apparently it's more convenient to say 15. But when we were talking basically about 150 trucks out, which also is 150 trucks in. And I just cannot imagine the survival of the Founding Fathers with that kind of traffic adjacent to our property, with the kids and everything else outside enjoying themselves. But anyway, I just want to bring that up. I thought it was kind of an unsaid thing. Thank you.
Questions for Don.
Don, could you have somebody check on the number of accidents?
Excuse me, if you want to.
I have to go up there and ask.
You have to address the commission. So. No, it's not supposed to be. You need to direct it at the panel.
Can anybody check out how many accidents have happened in, say, the last 5 years in Spring Creek Valley? Like right in front of Reptile Gardens and where Spring Creek Road goes east.
I'm sure the DOT is probably going to be doing that if this moves forward. And there's been a lot of concern, even like when we've had the helicopter issues and things like that. I know that there's a lot of things being looked at as far as the crossover traffic.
They do traffic analysis.
Thank you, though.
Thank you.
Thanks. Mr. Duhamel?
Either one.
I'm Bill Duhamel, and my family has Sitting Bull Crystal Caverns, which is across the Bear Country up at the top of the hill. And the biggest concern that I had initially was the public safety on the highway. But when we got into the blasting, I worry about, we have Sitting Bull Cave that runs down underneath there. And I'm worried about the safety down there. I don't know enough about blasting and seismographs. The woman for the mining scared the hell out of me. So I just am concerned. Now, that may be come up in the mining permit, and I hope we're invited to that also. But the original thing was just the highway safety. I had a good friend on the old Highway 16 coming on that hill that had an accident, somebody was killed. This was, God, we were in high school, so we're 60 years ago. And he was, missed a year of school with a broken back. But so I do worry about coming down that hill to there. Thank you.
Thanks. Questions for Bill?
I have to agree with Bill, because the caves mean there's fissures, and where are those fissures all underneath, and where do they stop? So that's a huge thing for aquifers and water quality, let alone if you blast, what that's going to do in that area.
Anyone else wishing to speak that hasn't had an opportunity yet? Does the applicant want to have any further comments? Staff's recommendation is...
Mr. Chair, if I might...
sorry, George.
I'd like to ask the applicant, based on the question that the gal...
if you could come up to the mic.
Talked about the geology, have you done any research or any testing based upon what she's presented to us?
I guess regarding the question, it was more of a geological study. Had that been completed? Is that the correct question?
Yes, yes.
As far as limestone, it is common in the Black Hills on the outskirts of the Black Hills, from Rapid City to Hot Springs, Edgemont, Newcastle, Sundown. So it is common on the outskirts. It's evident by other quarries. As far as a geological study, what's available in this corridor, we have not done a study.
Any anticipation whatsoever how far those shock waves might persist?
As far as blasting is concerned?
Yes.
We seismograph roughly 1,500 feet in any direction of any of our blasts. We measure noise and vibration. Everything meets state standard. We work in Wyoming, South Dakota, and so as far as what is the vibration level, I'd have to research it to figure out. You know, the quarry to the south does blasting. They don't do it today, they have in the past. It's been active for over 20 years. I have firsthand knowledge of that. And so it is common in the construction industry, in the limestone that is actively crushed in this area, that blasting is completed.
And you anticipate your blast would be about the same size as currently going on?
Sure, yeah. I mean, it does vary. We choose to shoot a little bit larger blast. Our experience has indicated larger blasts, we have less vibration than less noise than a smaller blast. Blasting is a kind of a unique experience. I'm not a mining engineer. A lot of things come into play. If we had heavy clouds, low atmosphere, you shoot the bigger small blast, you're going to get high noise because of the low atmosphere. A lot of the quarries that blast, whether it's Peatlean, GCC, Hills Materials, ourselves, it is unnoticed, but it is a part of the business.
You do understand the concern of water wells and certainly the cave across the road from you.
Yes, I do.
Thank you.
Other questions for the applicants?
I guess with the vibration noise and dealing with Black Hills Power out at Highway 79, if there is no granite or rock, those vibration go, and that decimal level goes a lot further if there's nothing to stop it. And that's why we ended up putting like a commercial barrier and stuff around that. So I don't know if I exactly agree with what you're saying on some of it. You've been doing it a long time, but when we were out there, they was telling us the same thing on those transformers. And those transformers were affecting the surrounding area. Just depend on, like the lady said earlier, I think it was Ms. Karen, about geological surveys and what's around the surrounding area. So I think that's a huge thing to get if you end up getting to do this, sir, is a geological survey. Because we ended up having to do one in that area because it was supposedly not going to affect the surrounding areas. Hmm. So I appreciate that, sir.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you. Someone else?
Well, I just had a question for you guys. So
Step up to the mic, please.
Yep, there it went again.
The question should be addressed to the
panel. Oh, I'm sorry. I had a question for these guys. Can I do that?
Well, or, not directly.
Oh, okay. I just wanted to know.
It needs to go through, formally go through the panel.
Okay. So. I just wanted to know, just with the tourism that's here, with the cave that's here, with the water concerns, all of that, I just do not understand why this location is what Carroll decided on. I mean, they've said themselves, it's, you know, shale and limestone, whatever is easy to get, limestone is easy to get in the hills. Why this location on a major tourist route through Rapid City, close to residential, close to tourism? I don't understand it.
Like I said, I'm allowing some latitude, you know, because they kind of opened the door on that in their presentation. But truly, this is about the rezone, and those questions are probably more appropriate for the mining permit construction.
When is that going to be? Don't know.
Until it's filed and they move forward, that's...
Okay, thank you.
And for all the audience and Kroll representatives too, I mean, we are a recommending body to the county commissioners, and the final decision is to the county commissioners, the county board. So,
thank you.
Any other one wishing to speak from the audience? Staff's recommendation is to deny without prejudice. Rezone 1507 and comprehensive amendments 1507. As the request does not compare to be compatible with current and future county zoning, and the applicant's request may be allowed to using current zoning plus permits without changing the current and future zoning for the subject properties. Anyone wishing to venture? I do have one question for staff. The recommendation for deny without prejudice versus just deny.
In case they come up with more information of why it would be more appropriate in their belief to go to heavy industrial, it gives them that 1 year to come back with an identical request.
Okay, thank you. Entertain a motion, either per staff's recommendation or as other motion.
Also move.
Staff
recommendation.
Motion and second per staff's recommendation. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion to deny without prejudice is approved. Take us back to agenda item 10. PJ? You suggest maybe taking a break now, or do you anticipate other items moving fairly quick?
I have to leave at 12, so if we can keep going, that would be cool.
Okay.
I have to move my car at 11.
Okay.
It's up to you. Either take a break now or 11.
Let's wait till 11, see where we're at 11.
There you go.
Thank you. Do you want me to wait for a minute?
No. We're still in session.
If you want to have discussions, please move outside. For the audience, if you're not staying around for the other items, please move outside for further discussion. Thank you.
Okay, Cassie Bolstead, Assistant Planning Director. Agenda item number 10 is conditional use permit review CU 1416 for Justin Kistler to review a double wide manufactured home to be used as a temporary residence. This conditional use permit was last reviewed on February 9th, and it was approved with one condition, that the double wide manufactured home be removed from the property by May 11th. The applicant's new residence is constructed. It is habitable. The double wide mobile home is still on the property. He was renting it. He is no longer renting it, has sold it. It is ready to be moved, but due to weather conditions and it being so wet, he hasn't been able to get it off the property. Rex was out there just this morning. He stated that it is ready to be moved. The skirting is off. It's disconnected from everything. He has the equipment. However, with the rains this past weekend again, it's still too wet for him to move. So staff is recommending to continue this item to the July 13th, 2015 Planning Commission meeting to give the applicant time to, hopefully it will stop raining and allow him to move the double wide off the property.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. Motion carried. Item 11.
Good morning, Brittany Molitor. I'm presenting minor plat 1513 for Rodney Alexander. The applicant is requesting to create lots 1 and 2 of Tin City Lode. The property is located outside of Hill City to the south on 385 off of Spring Creek Road West. Currently, it's a mining claim that's 10.33 acres. There's a storage warehouse building on the property that was built in 1986. There's also a foundation on the property, if you look right about here, that was constructed and nothing built on. And it was rezoned in 1996 from limited agriculture district to highway service. The applicant is proposing lot 1 of Tin City Lode, which would consist of 2.713 acres. It would maintain the highway service zoning district. It would still have the storage and warehouse building located on it. Lot 2 is currently zoned highway service district and is 7.615 acres. It would have the foundation. They're proposing to rezone that to low density residential district at a future date. They are also have a future request for subdivision regulation variances if this plat is approved. Currently, the access to this lot to Tin City Lode is off a easement granted by South Dakota Game Fish and Parks. And here you can kind of see it's a 12-foot wide gravel road. Or actually, Spring Creek Road West is. The easement is a two-track, about 8-foot wide road, and there's kind of what it is. The Game Fish and Parks has also not allowed them to improve the width of that. They can maintenance it and improve what's existing there, but they can't increase the width of it. So staff is recommending approval of minor plat 1513 with 9 conditions.
Questions for?
What if they close that road? What if the Forest Service or
Game Fish and Parks?
Game Fish and Parks decides that they don't want that anymore because they've done that in the past.
I do have a copy of the easement agreement. I did have Kinsley look at it. I did send this routing to the Game Fish and Parks and did not receive a response from them. I don't know, the applicant is here. I don't know if he has any concerns about them removing.
They closed that road. What we've seen in the past too is like Brittany had the property and then sold it to this man, and then whoever got stuck with the no easement in the past, or they shut that easement down, it was somebody else's problem. So I just, in Pennington County, I've seen that to be a big issue, is that something happens further down the road and somebody else gets stuck with what was on the property before.
The easement's public record, runs with the ground, and it runs, and it's an easement that's given and been approved by Game Fish. They say, in fact, they tell me they have no trouble improving the road or doing something more if they didn't have to mess with the federal government who put the money up for Game Fish to buy the land around us. But they, I don't think there's a way in the world that the court is going to allow an easement that's a public record and in the minutes and went through the courthouse. This isn't the type of stuff I've ever seen Game Fish change.
Okay, I appreciate that. I just don't want somebody to end up, if you yep. sell that property, sir, to make sure that easement is recorded and
certainly
and fully recognized.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, if I might, for the state's attorney, there's the easement's proper.
It is. I looked it over and it looks.
Thank you. I move approval, Mr. Chair.
A motion for approval.
Second.
Motion and second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, same sign. Motion carried. Item 12. Brittany, yours too?
Yes. I'll get this up here.
Okay.
Item 12 is minor plat 1512 and subdivision regulation variance 1506 to create lots 12R revised and lot 13 of Forest View subdivision. The property is located near the intersection of Highway 44 and 385. And the applicants want to increase the size of lot 12 and create lot 13. If you look at the up here, this is currently lot 12R. They want to increase this portion right here and then create this lot here.
What are they currently zoned?
They are currently zoned General Agriculture District and Suburban Residential District. So that small acreage, the 12R, they do have a rezone application next after this. They are proposing to rezone that portion that they're going to add to lot 12R to Suburban Residential and then rezone lot 13 to Suburban Residential District. So you can kind of see there. There's currently a 12-foot wide paved road there. Denny did have some concerns about a turnaround at the end of that property, because currently right now it's just this residence. There's a large area that you can turn around in. I did speak with the applicant, and they are going to work with Denny and Highway to see if they can work with something adequate, because as part of the subdivision regulations, they don't want to improve that.
How many acres are they going from to how many acres do they want now?
The lot 12. Lot 12R consists of 1.09 acres right now, and with the new request, they will go to 2.17 acres.
They're going bigger.
Yes. And then lot 13 would consist of 1.42 acres and is currently vacant, and they want to put a single-family residence on that lot.
So why are they doing suburban residential rezone?
Because the current zoning is General Agriculture District, and they wouldn't meet the lot size requirements. And there's other lots. The other lots in this area have already been rezoned to suburban residential.
And that area can handle the water and the septic systems for suburban residential?
They've asked to do the percolation and profile hole information at the time of building and not now, at the time of platting. That is one of their subdivision regulation variance requests, is to waive the percolation and profile hole information.
So
at this time.
Ahead, no, you go ahead, sir.
Sure.
The way I understand is that there, right now there are two lots there, and they're removing the property line, making in that green area appears to be two lots now.
No, there's actually one lot now. It's kind of a, let's see, let me go back. That 12R.
Green one.
The green one.
Mm-hmm.
This one right here is existing. And if you look, it just kind of is a floater out there, as you can kind of call it. It's just a small acreage lot that was platted in the middle of that larger portion. This is the larger portion right here that they're platting that 13 and 12 out of, and a small portion of this property right here.
Yeah, I was, it shows an old lot line in the middle of that 12R on the plat, and that's what I was, made me think they were just removing that and increasing.
They are removing that because they're going to make 12R larger. They're going to make it from 1.09 acres to 2.17 acres.
So they're making, okay.
12R larger and creating 13 with this plat. So when they are requesting to waive, to increase the width of the 40-foot wide private access easement to a 66-foot wide private access easement, they're requesting to waive the improvement of the private access easement to a 24-foot wide road with paved surface curb and sidewalks. They're requesting to waive engineered road construction plans to improve the section line right-of-way, to submit topographic information at 5-foot contour intervals, and requesting to waive the submission of percolation test and profile hole information. Staff is recommending approval of 5 of those 6 subdivision regulation variances. They're requesting to waive improvement of the access easement to a 24-foot wide road. If you look at the road, it's a nice 12-foot wide paved road. It's in good condition. When we were up there, it was easy to get through there. There's only one car. There'll be three residences on this. They want waiving improvement of the section line right of way. They really don't need to improve the section line because they do have access through that 40-foot wide access easement. The topographic information in the submission of the percolation test and profile information. There was concern from County Highway and the fire coordinator about not increasing that right of way to 66 feet and leaving it at 40 feet. So staff is recommending denial of that subdivision regulation variance to waive that request. There was also some concern from emergency services and our addressing coordinator that this platted drive would have to be named because there would be more than five residences on there.
My concern is for the future of suburban residential, putting that on these lots. And then for future, what would we have to stop them since they are zoned that?
To subdivide.
Into now. Different other lots of pieces. How about that?
Sure. For a well and septic, they do have to have a minimum of 1 acre. So they wouldn't be able to go under 1 acre unless they got a community water system. Then they could go down to 20,000 square feet.
And who checks that to make sure that doesn't happen?
When they subbed, that would come back in front of the Planning Commission and the board if they wanted a future to subdivide it. When they're platting, yes.
So if it was denied for the 66-foot right-of-way, then the minor plat has to come back to show the 66-foot?
No, they would have to show that on their Mylar before they register or file it with the Register of Deeds. So we get the Mylars after they're all signed. We review it to make sure that all the conditions that you guys set on it and the Board of Commissioners set on it are met. So they would have to show the 66-foot wide access easement on the Mylar, and then they'll actually have to show the named road also. I believe that's one of the conditions.
And I assume the applicant's not here. Are they aware of the staff's recommendation for denial that keeping it 40 feet?
We did talk to them, but I have not heard from Ron Davis. I thought he would be here today. Typically he's here at the meetings, but I have not heard from him. We did meet with them last week and go over some of the other.
Other questions for Brittany? I guess take the subdivision variances first. The staff's recommendation is to approve 5 of the 6 with the one I just mentioned, the providing 66-foot wide instead of them requesting to keeping it 40. Entertain a motion to that effect or alternate motion?
I'd make a motion to accept the recommendation. Approval recommendation.
We have a second.
Second.
Motion and second. Further discussion?
Mr. Chair, without the applicant's input, are they okay with it, you think? Or don't you have any idea if the applicant's okay with the denial of the 66-foot wide easement?
They do receive a copy of the staff report, so I have not heard. It'll increase where the buildable road area is. It won't change their platting request. I mean, it'll change the 40-foot wide to 66-foot wide, so they'll lose a portion of that area. I don't know if it would change setbacks or anything. I have not heard from the applicant since they received the staff report.
Well, and this goes to
county. This goes to the board.
For final approval, so they would have the opportunity to, even if we vote one way, to oppose it at county board.
Well, I feel uncomfortable voting without their input. As you suggest, it's merely, well, I shouldn't say merely, but it's nothing to do with the physical layout. It has to do with 66 feet of right-of-way on the plat.
Correct.
Easement. And which may or may not be used at some future point in time. But I don't feel comfortable voting without applicant's input.
It would require the applicant to reduce the size of all these lots because of the, you're taking out another additional 16 or 26 feet of,
so they're doing
of property. You're widening it enough to make, so each of these lots would have to be made smaller.
Would you want to offer a substitute motion?
Which may affect setbacks.
Which
may affect setbacks.
Right.
Right.
And I guess that's my
setbacks
concern.
The setbacks would stay whatever they are, but the lot sizes would have to be reduced because of the additional 26 feet of right-of-way.
But I think what George is saying is they may have to move their house an additional 16 feet. It'll still be 25-foot setback, but that,
right,
that edge where you're measuring the 25-foot setback is now moving, correct?
In essence, there's a new property line.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right.
And I guess that's my concern, and I'd make a substitute motion to continue this item until such time as the applicant gets a chance to weigh in on the staff's recommendation.
Do I have a second? Substitute motion?
Was to continue. George wanted to continue.
To postpone it until such time as the applicant has a chance to for an input on this.
Yeah, that's fine.
Well, they have a chance to come to.
They have a chance to come to the
county commission.
County
so
commission board.
They still have a chance to.
So, we have a motion on the floor, motion second to approve it. If they want to come to the county commission meeting and reject change that, I would say.
George's substitute motion is basically to continue it here.
I would just go ahead with my initial motion.
Right now, we don't have a second on the substitute motion. I guess we're back to the original motion. Motion is for approval of the five of the six subdivision variances. Any further discussion?
Obviously, I'd be voting no because I don't think that's the issue is properly aired. But thank you.
Well, I understand your point, but they do have the opportunity to oppose it at county board. So,
I believe they would have came today if they opposed. That's all I'm saying, because it says approval.
The process to me is for this body to recommend and after having fully vetted and fully researched the issue and not just pass the buck. And anyway, go ahead and vote.
Well, I agree with what Deb indicated, that Ron Davis is usually pretty good at being here if he opposes staff's recommendations. So, anyway, motion second on the floor is for approval for staff's recommendation on the variances. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
And I abstain because there's insufficient information from the decision.
Motion is carried with four. That takes us to the minor layout plat approval.
Staff is recommending approval with 9 conditions.
That'd be my motion.
Do I have a second? Pardon me? Jerry?
Which one was that?
We're doing the 13. Basically 15, for the recommending on the minor plat 15-12 with 9 conditions. We have a motion on the floor. Do I have a second?
Second.
Motion and second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Motion carried. Takes us to item 13.
Item 13 is rezone 1506 and comprehensive plan amendment 1506 to rezone 2.5 acres from general agriculture district to suburban residential district and to amend the Pennington County comprehensive plan to change the future land use from planned unit development sensitive to suburban residential district. So these are the same lots. What they're asking to rezone is this portion of lot 12R and lot 13. That's the 2.5 acres.
Being continued, Brittany?
Pardon?
Number 13 being continued. It says continued from. No rezone.
This was continued from the previous.
Yes, ma'am. Sorry.
Planning Commission. So staff is recommending approval of rezone 1506 and comprehensive plan amendment 1506.
Any questions for Brittany?
Hearing none, entertain motion to, for staff's recommendation or alternate motion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second for approval of rezone 1506 and comp plan amendment 1506. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Same sign. Motion carried.
Thank you.
Ready addressed item 14, so we're on to item 15.
Do you want to take a break before this? No? I got to move my car at 11.
Okay. Anybody need a break?
Well,
I just wondered if you, you know.
It's up to you if it takes 11.
Because we're not going to be able to finish the agenda by 11.
No, I don't believe
so. This is short compared to our.
But I mean, go ahead, that's no, fine. I just have to move my car at 11, that's all. Yeah.
Why don't we take a 5-minute break? Or, I don't know.
Well, I'd hate to keep Mr. Morris waiting any longer.
Let's process
let's
that.
Let's do this.
Getting the presentation pulled up here for you. Item before you is item 15, rezone 1502 and comprehensive plan amendment 1502 to rezone 151.36 acres from general agriculture district and light industrial to general commercial, and to amend the Pennington County comprehensive plan to change the future land use from limited agriculture district to general commercial district. The applicant owner is Mitch Morris. He is in the audience today. The current zoning, as indicated, general agriculture district and light industrial. This is a rezone request and comp plan. It's been in your packets for couple months, been presented a couple times. Essentially, on the subject property, there is a single-family residence on the northwest corner. If the rezone was approved, that single-family residence will become a secondary purpose on the property next against general commercial, so a conditional use permit would be required. The applicant has already filled out the conditional use permit, but since there is not a violation currently on the property for that use, staff advised him not to submit it, but we do have a copy of the original. Additional on the property in the northwest corner is also a residential garage built in 1960 and two utility buildings built in the 1940s. Further down into the area here that I'm circling with my cursor, that is the area that's zoned light industrial. There's currently a contractor's equipment storage yard and a racetrack. The racetrack currently has a conditional use permit on it from 2000. It was approved with 10 conditions and reviewed on a complaint basis. And as of writing of the staff report, our department has not received any complaints that would warrant a review of that racetrack. If the other item that staff had talked about earlier with the applicant is the equipment storage yard, and the applicant has indicated that instead of taking it off the property, he would actually like to, if it was zoned to general commercial, actually begin selling automobiles on the commercial property, which is a permitted use in general commercial, and he would also like to sell construction equipment if it was rezoned to general commercial. Essentially, the items that are currently on the lot, he would just then begin to sell them. Selling the automobiles, as indicated, is a permitted use. Selling construction equipment is a conditional use, so he then would also need an additional conditional use permit for that item. So staff has asked in the staff report that the Planning Commission make a recommendation that the applicant sign a statement of understanding about the permits that would be required if this was rezoned. Essentially, the conditional use permit for the single family resident if it was rezoned. The racetrack would have to come up with that conditional use permit would have to come up for a review because it's zoned in light industrial, and if it was zoned to general commercial, we just basically have to review it for the new zoning. Also, a conditional use permit to be able to sell the construction equipment on the subject property. Also, as an item of note that's in your staff report, the applicant has also submitted a rezone and comprehensive plan amendment for 30.49 acres of additional land, which is right about here. That will be heard at a later date, but it is contiguous and with the same applicant, so staff felt it was an item of note to put into the staff report. But concerning items, item 1502 and comprehensive plan amendment 1502, staff recommends approval.
Questions for PJ? I guess I had one comment. I assume that's just in the update, which is update June 8, 2015.
Mm-hmm.
It says continue rezone to their June 26th meeting, and I believe
June 16th. I believe that's what that's supposed to say.
Well, the minutes were June 8th, today's meeting.
Right.
And so
that's today. So the next Board of Commissioners meets on the 16th, I believe.
Well, it says the Planning Commission's recommendation.
Oh, Board of Commissioners. Got it. I see what you're saying. So I'll need a motion to change that.
So anyway, but...
Thank you for catching that. I see what you're saying.
So do we have to change that, or are we good? Just change it?
Well, it's just staff's report recommendation. It's not part of the actual...
Rezone?
Right.
So just more of a correction there.
Nope, that's fine.
And I think you answered my other question. I wasn't clear, I guess, whether that 39 is part of today's action, but it is not.
It's separate, okay. Yeah.
Well, and if you look across the highway, it's all zoned general commercial as well. So it does go kind of with the comprehensive plan.
If you want me to go into a little more detail, I can, but I know these guys have read this several times and it's been presented. Just what Commissioner Hadcock has indicated, across the street, it's currently general commercial. The future land use across the street is planned unit development. The applicant's area that he's asking to have rezoned, future land use is general commercial for a majority of what he's requesting, not all of it.
Thank you. And then just... I know he has came for commercial or general commercial in the next piece before and been denied before, but just a little history. We rezoned by the, say it, ACDC, what's it called?
We call it a DC tie.
I say converter, he says tie. So we rezoned that area because of the noise and vibration and decided that commercial would be the best buffer for that ACDC tie planning commission. So bringing that commercial back a little bit further in the future, I don't think was such a bad thing because you don't want to put houses across the street from that thing. So just from dealing with that ACDC tie from Planning Commission all the way to City Council, just a little reference on that. If that does come forward, that you have a little bit that that converter is right across the street or pretty close to it. In the district or the area that that vibrates or causes issues does have some rock formations in there, which does make it worse. So if there's not a buffer. So just a little bit of future information, because I've heard it's been denied before, but it does make sense once you know the history of that DC tie, AC-DC tie.
Mr. Morris is here. Are you wishing to say anything? Staff's recommendation is for approval.
Just if you have any questions.
Questions for the applicant that bring him forward? If not, staff's recommendation is for approval of rezone 1502 and comp plan amendment 1502.
Oh, and I guess I should disclose I had a telephone conversation with Mr. Morris. I don't know if he called all you guys, but.
Okay. And. I think he tried leaving me a message, but I just, it was so garbled I couldn't tell who was calling. But I thought I heard Mitch, but then I couldn't understand it, and I did not return the call, but wasn't sure.
So. I talked to Mr. Morris, too, and just had some questions about why we were what we questioned in the last meeting, and that was it.
Me and PJ met with them way before then, just on some of the stuff. So, well, I always gather information. It was from the last meeting of some of his stuff, not this exactly, but I did talk to him just about some of his stuff for the future because that AC-DC converter issue. So, but I would move approval.
I had one other comment too, or do I have to wait till a discussion?
Well, we have a motion right now. I guess take a second, and then we can have a discussion.
Okay, second.
Motion and second. Lori.
My only comment was I guess I'd like to relay to the staff that, you know, we continued this thinking that the reason Mr. Morris wasn't at the previous meeting was because he thought it was going to be continued. And that was one of the reasons, you know, like on that previous one we talked about maybe continuing it. I don't think we should try to guess why people are or aren't here. Mm-hmm. If it seems like it's a valid recommendation, I think we should act on it. because I think it ends up wasting a lot of people's time.
Okay.
But it, just a comment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, staff asked to continue it because there's been a lot of questions
yeah.
that were raised,
yeah.
and that was staff recommendations. The board's opinion was that it was for other reasons.
Yeah.
A motion second for approval per staff's recommendation. Any further discussion?
Mr. Chair, how do we reconcile the city's concern?
What?
How do we reconcile, we Pennington County reconcile the city's concern about doesn't fit with their future land use?
I say we're coinciding at this point, being that they want a general commercial buffer around that ACDC converter and his land is right next to it.
I think that's an ongoing question we have on these joint areas where we're in the 3-mile platting jurisdiction. I guess my opinion is that it seems appropriate and then follows the county's comp plan right now if we need to modify the county's plan. But I know we've had some actions where, basically deferred to the cities. But in this case, I think it does seem appropriate around 79 for Highway 79 to me, and it's consistent with the county's plan.
Can I ask our attorney a question? When you get into issues like this, where the city and county, comprehensive plans are in disagreement, who makes the call?
Oh.
If the applicant or somebody questions it, does it have to go to court?
I guess it would go to court either.
Well, right now the city doesn't. They have planning jurisdiction, but they don't have zoning.
Yeah,
the city. So the counties would trump for anything that would go to court. Currently, if he contested it not being rezoned,
mm-hmm.
So the counties would trump.
So there really wouldn't be an issue then.
Yeah, there wouldn't really be an issue.
The city just has to back off then.
The city's going to have their own. Not with the zoning, but the city's going to have their own regulations if and when he goes into plat.
I mean, and at this point, basically, the city's is just a recommendation, right?
Yeah, we just request a comment.
Okay.
Correct.
Okay.
The future land use, being on the future land use board on the city, Ms. Litson, they changed theirs depending, kind of like Pennington County does, as where for the future of where things are going or moving. So they've changed theirs, and we, as commissioner or council people, kind of do what you guys did. Same with the county. Just do what makes or do what is appropriate for that area at the time. If it becomes start becoming a business district, they make it commercial. If they decide to do residential, then they try to stick with residential and then do neighborhood plans and different stuff for those commercial areas. But I haven't seen a comprehensive plan from the city or the county that has stayed like it was supposed to, meaning what they had planned.
So I guess my question is, we're not creating a problem by doing this if it's not in agreement with the city's recommendation.
You're not creating
we have the jurisdiction
issue, a legal issue, okay. or anything like that. It's completely up to the county in this respect and the city's future land use or current comprehensive plan isn't going to trump the county's for some reason. So.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, if I might, the bottom line is that no matter what we do or don't do, the city has planning jurisdiction. And if it,
what?
And if Mr. Morris goes to plat and they say, here's what you got to do or can't do, and it's contrary to our zoning. Our zoning is neither here nor there; just goes away. So, whatever we do as a county should be in concert with the city. That the city has the hammer.
No offense, but I was in the city, and that's not true.
Excuse me, I wasn't done. The city has the hammer on platting. Period. So at some point in time, we, this county and Rapid City, need to get together and decide how we're going to settle these differences in the 3-mile platting area. I'm done now. Thank you.
I agree with that, George. But they are not in charge of our district and we're not in charge of theirs. So you can say that all day long, but you don't always have to be in agreement to get things done. If someone wants to do something, George, just from seeing in the city, I'd like to see you try to make a difference in that mile or 3 mile, because it's been many years, and if that's your choice, that would be awesome. But there was reasonings why they did that, just because you affect us and we affect them. Because I've seen in the, how about this? For future land use, we in the city, when we got people or had people annex in, that infrastructure cost the city a lot of money for what the county approved. So when you're doing your suburban residentials, or we're doing our LDRs, or we're doing plats or rezones that don't fit, it's because there's not enough water, sewer, gutter systems for that city to take care of it. So when they annex in, that's why the city a lot of times doesn't want to annex in anything with the county, because it would cost them millions to fix what we approved on our plans. So we too, as a county, need to see what the city's doing just as much as the city needs to see what we're, you know, vice versa. So both areas have issues. And how you fix that, you're going to tell people to stop doing suburban residential because curb and gutter, sidewalks, storm sewers aren't there yet. And if that's your wish, then that would probably be the city's wish, because they don't want you to do any of that. And if you've ever, planners, you know that. I've been on the Planning Commission as well for the city beforehand. And if you can change that, George, and you can require as a county to do curb, gutter, sidewalk, in all those stipulations of city, then I don't think you're going to get a lot of building in the county anywhere close to Rapid City, because they'll say it does not fit. And you don't like the county rules already, George, and the Planning Commission rules, or the planning rules. Can you imagine if you start thinking you have to pull out city rules on this Planning Commission, because I don't think you'll have a lot of people building.
We do have a motion and second for approval for staff's recommendations, George.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, I didn't clearly state my point. My point is that Mr. Morris and all the developers in the 3 mile platting jurisdiction of Rapid City have two bosses. And anybody who's been around a couple of years knows that you can't have two bosses. Having said that, my point is that Rapid City and Pennington County need at some point in time sit down and get together and decide how we, our government, are going to treat developers. Thank you.
Any further discussion? Motion is for approval per staff's recommendation. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Aye.
That was
opposed.
Okay. No. Jerry, can I have a roll call? I don't know if I heard a four yeses. So.
Phil?
Yes.
Deb?
Aye.
Aye.
Mark? Yes.
Large?
No.
Passed.
Thank you.
I have a ticket anyway, so I guess I can, if I have a ticket.
Well, there's five of us, we can all pony up a buck.
I have a ticket for another 2 hours, so it's irrelevant.
Sorry.
That's okay.
We're at item 16.
16.
Kind of ties to some of the discussion we're just having. So.
Yep, and it actually has been coming up for years since I've been here, at least. The comprehensive plan was tackled previously with the other director. The commissioners at the time felt that it wasn't necessary, and the current commissioners on both the Planning Commission and the Board of Commissioners and staff feel that it's time for a review. It was last written in 2003. It was last updated in 2003, and staff has a list of things that would like to change, minor little things here and there, like staff position titles that no longer exist, but they're still in the comprehensive plan. But more importantly, We want to look at the comprehensive plan, look at the zoning ordinance, look at the floodplain ordinance, and have it revised, have it updated, because things are constantly moving, things are constantly changing. Before you is a list of reasons to revise the Pennington County Comprehensive Plan. This was submitted by Commissioner Hall, who's not in attendance today, but she wanted to make sure that you all had it. And what staff is looking for is a recommendation in writing from the Planning Commission to the Board of Commissioners that we pursue updating our comprehensive plan. Staff has asked in the budget for the next couple years to allocate monies for this purpose.
So this is George Fairby or George?
Karen Hall.
What?
Commissioner Hall.
This one is. The
Reasons to revise? Yeah, she okay. submitted that, correct.
Sorry,
George did it.
Does it say George on it somewhere?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's why I thought George did it.
Where does it?
No, on Deb's copy only.
I didn't write that.
Oh, that's why I was like, okay.
Yeah, here's mine.
It doesn't mine either. Yeah.
So
here's the only one.
Yes, PJ, I think this is an important topic, but with three of our regular commissioners, I would almost like to see this in discussion of the House bill and some of those items deferred. Well,
As far as item 16, the staff would concur on that. House Bill 1194, once you see it, you'll understand.
Okay.
We don't need to continue it.
Okay.
And again, even with the future land use and being on them, I'll just tell you guys, it's not followed. I was on the board for 6 years and then on the Planning Commission. So, PJ, not to burst this bubble on comprehensive plan, but I some of the stuff makes sense, water and FEMA and all that stuff, but I'll just tell you, it's hard to tell people what to do with their land and then come in and say, we're going to tell you what to do with that land. We think it's best there, so that's what we're doing. And some of the areas you know because it's built out with residentials or business districts, but when they're coming out further, how do you say no? Or how do you say yes? Because you decided as a plan that we should or shouldn't?
Right, and I see what you're saying. And updating now the comprehensive plan would be able to match the current trends and also getting citizen input, which is critical to this. But you can't you can't just update a comprehensive plan without updating everything else. You want everything to be in harmony. So hopefully make it more in tune with what the citizens and the commissioners see as far as the direction of Pennington County for the next 10, 15 years until it's revised again.
I appreciate that. You'll probably get the citizens and this planning board to do it, but when it comes to politics, I'll just tell you, it's not hardly ever followed.
Yep.
But it is, if you want to do it as a recommending thing, that's fine. I'll just say it up straight to you, PJ.
Yep, we'll take the hits.
Nope.
Ask a question.
Yep.
Sorry.
What did you want to?
I recall the last time that the reason this wasn't followed through on was because of budgeting, because of the cost. Has that been addressed? You said in the budget, you've budgeted for an update of this?
Yeah, originally what was asked for to update the comprehensive plan itself was $126,000. An additional 46 and change was to also add in the zoning ordinance. So Dan had requested $172,000 in one lump sum. Staff is looking at actually phasing it over the course of possibly 2 years to spread the cost out.
And again, it would be done by an outside consultant?
We'll have to see where it goes. That's all part of discussion. But we figure we had that for budgeting purposes, we had to ask for the money now.
Anyway, like I said, I think it's an important discussion. I hate to delay it because we pushed it back kind of with the changes and staff changes we've had, but at the same time with three of the regular planning commissioners gone this time, I'd like to have that discussion with them available on that too.
Okay.
We need a motion to that effect or?
There's no motion on there, just discussion.
Okay. Go to county board report then.
The Board of Commissioners concurred with
before we leave that item, do we need a handwriting expert to see who put George on that?
Somebody crazy.
Sorry, George. Didn't help you any there, did I?
Yeah, go ahead, sorry.
Mr. Chair, 17 now? Is that okay?
Yeah, county board report.
The Board of Commissioners concurred with the Planning Commission's recommendation for the May 26, 2015 Planning Commission meeting. Also rezone 1503 and comprehensive plan amendment 1503 for Mitch Morris were denied. That was upon his request. That was a 2,500 home request. The Board of Commissioners will also be advertising for an additional member and an alternate member for the Vacation Home Rental Committee.
Brought that up last time. Is there going to be an advertisement for the next round of Planning Commissioners?
Yes, that's already gone out.
It's on there.
That's already
out there.
I haven't looked at it, so I apologize. So.
It's out.
18.
Items from the public. I don't see any, unless he's hiding behind UPJ. I don't see any public out there. Items from staff.
Item A, building permit report. As you can see with what was given before you, single family residents for year to date are up 33% over last year. Pole barn sheds are up over 40% over last year. Garages, carports, they're pretty much even for last year. So overall, we're up 9% over this time last year as far as building permits.
Cool.
Any questions?
But down a little bit on the dollars side of it, right?
Yeah, we were actually thinking of taking the valuation column off. I mean, we're not really in that business, but if you'd like to keep it on there, we could. We wouldn't do it till next year, though.
Leave it for now, so.
Yep.
I guess the House Bill.
Sure. House Bill 1194, and I do actually have a visual for this one. Basically required zoning hearing signs to be resized for conditional use permits and rezones. This is our current dilapidated conditional use permit request sign. We have a number of these. Basically, it doesn't meet the size requirements. It's supposed to be now, according to the new House bill, 24 inches wide and 18 inches high. Staff has also decided to change the color to blue and white so it stands out a little bit more and doesn't get absorbed into the background of trees or anything that would be of natural color. We do anticipate more phone calls this way, but we also believe that it is important for the public to know what's going on. So we're looking to change conditional use permit signs to this. This is current rezone sign, again, green and white, kind of matches the environment. Same thing, had to be 18 by 24, and we're looking to go red and white on that as well. They've already been ordered. It's going to cost us about $1,400 to get them, and they will be hopefully in our pipeline by July 1st. And the Highway Department is working with the Planning Department to get them made.
Are they the same color as the cities?
Cities are yellow and black, and they have a red background white lettered conditional use permit liquor sign.
Because I thought I'd seen the city ones, they're blue and white. Blue background, white letters.
I asked in the city, they said they're all yellow and black, and then that specific red and white one, person I talked to in their planning
department.
Remember
the blue ones? What are the blue ones for?
I don't know.
They used to have blue ones, solid blue background with white
letters. With white letters?
Yeah.
Okay. But their new ones are black and yellow.
Person I talked to, yep, black and yellow, and then the red and white one just for conditional use permit liquor signs.
And so you intentionally have them a different color so they're not the same as the cities?
Yes.
That was an intentional thing?
Yes, and that's why the conditional use permit is not red and white, white and red. And we've also checked with the Highway Department to make sure that our colors are allowed, and state's attorneys also checked state statute to make sure that our color requests are allowed. So
how would they know if they are county or city? Since we don't have that on the
this
sign.
This is 394. Well, it could be city or county.
Yeah
that's
be.
What I'm saying. But you can call the phone number.
What is the material that made out of? Aluminum?
Cardboard.
That sign.
They're going to be whatever a regular like speed limit stop sign
is
made out of.
I was just thinking that size, you're going to need two posts, so it's not.
Not that thick. It's not going to be that gauge.
Okay.
We're going to be able to do a normal T-post with U-channel with this, just like we've been using.
Are applicants being pretty good about placing them visibly, as far as you're aware?
As far as we're aware, yes. Rezones staff puts out. What they're not good about are returning them.
Oh.
And so whatever the final cost is this becomes and what it goes across as far as the average, we may be coming back and asking to update our deposit. Right now it's $50 per sign. And when we take into account staff time, the U-channel, plus materials to post a sign and the sign itself, it may go over $50.
Do you have guidelines or set requirements for where the sign is placed?
Yes, we do. and also who places them and when.
Okay. I ran into a situation where, this was a number of years ago, but the sign was placed in the bottom of the gully that you couldn't see. So.
Oh.
But it was posted.
It was posted.
I tend to agree with Bill at 24-inch wide, and posted in the middle, to do some flipping.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Well, right now, our current...
They don't have to be there very long, right?
Right. Our current signs are close, off by a couple inches, but because of the House bill, we have to get them all redone. So they are heavy, and they're not fun to put up.
Who puts those up for you guys?
For us, it kind of depends who goes out there on our on the ones we
need. I always thought the applicant did, but
on some of them they do,
okay.
Not all of them.
Okay.
Yeah. December meeting?
Yeah. Right now we're looking at scheduled at 9 a.m. on the 7th. And on the 21st, talked with Janet. She's still not sure what time her meeting is going to be done, but sometime after 12, 1 o'clock. So it's too early to be able to guess at what time to be able to schedule that meeting.
But still guessing like one or two, or
it's possible. Yep. We'd have to see what her we have to see what her workload looks like when we get closer.
I'll be in November. I don't care. Just
kidding. Well, it's this, like, this is adding a second meeting in December is what we're looking at. We historically just have done the one meeting in December. So
I was here when you guys had the discussion in January.
Trying to keep things off the Board of Commissioners' plates.
Do I have that meeting in December?
Items from membership. Any other items to discuss today? Now to entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
We're adjourned.
Thank you. Adjourned.